Learn all the ways that SQL is getting smarter across SQL Server and Azure SQL from 2017 to today and even beyond, this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Kate Smith, a program manager on the SQL team. Kate, thanks so much for joining us today.
Hi, Anna. Thank you so much for having me on.
It's great to have you on the show again, although I think it's been some time if you don't include our May 4th wonderful episodes. But today, we're going to be talking about intelligent query processing. And I'm excited about this because we've got a couple episodes in the mix that are happening on this topic. And we're going to kick it off with this one, talking about, you know, where we've been and where we are now, and maybe even some insights on where we're going. But if we could just back up to the beginning and say, like, what is intelligent query processing?
Yeah, what is it, right? That's a lot to unpack, because intelligent is sort of a loaded word, right? What does intelligent mean, right? In our SQL engine, intelligent means that it learns, right? So things happen and we adjust on the fly to what's happening. We don't do that with training models. We don't have MI or LLMs, not right now, right? No promises about the future, right? There's always room to dream, but not right now. That's not any part of a released product or pending product to be released. So it's heuristic based, and it only learns from your workload. So we don't train on other models or anything like that. It's all sort of private to your data set, to what's happening in your workload with your data and your queries. But it makes a difference. We impact like billions of queries a day in Azure alone. This suite of products is incredibly impactful.
Wow. And then one more question before we get into some of the details. Like you just mentioned, in Azure alone. So is this a SQL Server feature, an Azure SQL feature, kind of like a both, or how does that work?
This is SQL Engine. So it goes everywhere, right? It goes into the Box product, SQL Server. It goes into Azure SQL. It goes into MI. It goes into like pretty much anywhere the SQL Engine goes, this stuff goes to.
Okay. Awesome. Love it. And I love your kind of title for it. So I'd love to like, let's go back in time and see what we've done.
Yeah, we've come a long way. So let's have a look at the slide that has, I have a thing here that shows sort of the overview of everything we have. There's a lot on this family tree, right? And it just keeps growing every year. So instead of trying to tackle all this at once, let's tackle it, release by release, right? And I'm gonna sort of gate them by SQL Server releases, because that is when we do compatibility level bumps. If you're familiar with those in the SQL engine, each of these features is gated by compatibility level in some way. And so each new compatibility level would release new features. All right, so let's start with the very first wave, right? We start out with some things in adaptive query processing, right? Adaptive joins, which only work in batch mode, allow you, if you're executing a query, you can, we can decide, well, we're doing like a nested loops join, but it looks like this is actually going to be a bigger join than we thought, and switch over to doing a hash join on the fly. Interleaved execution is another way of being adaptive. We start to compile a query, and then we'll go off and execute an MSTVF that might be part of that query, and then come back and finish the compilation. And then memory grant feedback, which is a feature you're going to hear about a lot in this presentation because it just keeps growing. It started out in batch mode. The idea is if each query in SQL Server is allocated memory at compile time to run with. And if you give that query too much memory, you inhibit parallelism. If you give it too little memory, you're going to end up in a situation where you might spill to disk. And that's really costly. And it slows down a query a lot because now you're doing disk writes, right? And so memory grant feedback remembers in 2017, we just remember what happened last time. And then we adjust so that in subsequent executions, we just look at what we did, what happened last time, and we adjust based on that. Which is pretty cool. Like I said, it's smart and it's learning from what's happening in your workload.
And at this point in the journey, we called it adaptive query processing, right?
We did. That was what we called it. Yeah. Yeah.
Nice.
We've grown. Yeah. All right. Let's go on. So the next release that came out, SQL 2019. it grew a lot, right? We rebranded. We're now intelligent query processing. We've got a bunch of new features. Memory grant feedback now works in row mode, right? So it's the same functionality, but targeting row mode queries as well. We also have sort of approximate query processing is a new concept that we developed in 2019. The idea that, I mean, it's pretty intuitive, right? If you're going to like plan a party, right, you don't really need to know the exact numbers of people who are coming and the exact number of pieces of pizza they're going to eat before you order pizza. You kind of just need an idea and you can order your pizza, right? Approx, count, distinct is kind of the similar idea. Just give me an idea without wasting a lot of resources to make it perfect because it's not relevant for the answer it needs. So you can get a faster answer when error can be tolerated, right? Does that make sense?
Yep, that makes sense.
And so that's what the approximate query processing is as an idea. And the first release of that was for count distinct operations. We also added the ability for batch mode operations to execute on row stores. So even if there's situations where you can't or don't want to create a column store index, you can still get some of the power of batch mode query execution in row store for relevant or applicable situations, which is pretty great. And then table variable deferred compilation and scalar UDF inlining both take kind of common anti-patterns problem points with the way queries execute and fixes them. Scalar UDF inlining will actually unpackage that user-defined function and make it part of the compilation. So it's more like compiled with the rest of the query, unlocking better compilation for the query overall. And table variable deferred compilation will actually say, okay, we're compiling the query, and then we hit a table variable and we'll actually go off, execute a little bit, get an actual number, and then use that to inform the rest of our compilation.
Right? Gotcha. Okay, really cool. I have one question because I'm seeing a trend among some of these. And uh-huh. Then approximate count distinct doesn't quite fit in that trend. I think you probably know where I'm going with this, right? Okay. Like a lot of the intelligent query processing are like, it just runs faster with no code right. changes. So can right. you tell me a little bit more about kind of the thinking and maybe even how it works for approximate query processing?
Right. So approximate query processing, you're right, it's different because it's actually triggered by a T-SQL command, right? We're not going to go off and do an approximate query execution unless you tell us that approximate is okay because it's less accurate, because we trade off the precision for time, right? And so it's actually new additions to T-SQL that will allow you to unlock these functions.
Okay, yeah. Got it. That makes sense. Also similar on scalar UDF inlining. I'm not sure that you mentioned that one. How does that one work?
So like I said, it's sort of, you have a user-defined function defined in T-SQL, and we can actually like unpack that T-SQL and compile it the way we compile the rest of the query plan. So you unlock better compilation by doing that.
Nice.
Yeah. All right. Shall we move on to the latest and greatest?
Let's see. It's also funny because I remember each of these happening and each one's right. like, oh yeah. So
right. I know. I can't wait until like the next wave and like, how, I don't, we're going to have to like start like making a bigger picture. I don't know how we're going to put them all on, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Right. So here we've got query processing feedback. We started with memory grant feedback and we expanded it. We added two new types of feedback. Cardinality estimation or CE feedback and degree of parallelism or DOP feedback. Both of those, I'm going to talk with you a little bit more in a different video, but quickly, cardinality estimation feedback. The idea is you start with a baseline cardinality estimation module, right? We have sort of a baseline, a default, but that's sort of like it's a default, right? So it's not going to be perfectly tailored to your query or your data. And in some situations, a slight change in the cardinality estimation model would be more applicable to this query in this setting. And so we can actually figure out what that change is by looking at you've executed the query. So we've got a compilation information and then we've got execution information. We can compare and then adjust, if appropriate, along certain vectors of or certain dimensions of cardinality estimation model changes. degree of parallelism feedback. The idea is that we execute a query that has parallelism, and if it looks like maybe we could try a slightly lower degree of parallelism, we can do that. We don't like make a big jump. We just slowly work down till we achieve a place of the fastest query with the minimum amount of parallelism for that speed. And that's, we call that parallel efficiency. And that is really great for saving resources and getting good performance. And we also improved our algorithm for memory grant feedback. Instead of just looking at what we did last time, we look at more of the history, right? And then we can actually, so if you have a query that oscillates, right? It needs a lot of memory, then not much memory, a lot of memory, not much memory. We can actually remember that that happened and provide a memory grant such that we prevent spills, right? So we're going to go for the higher level of memory grant and prevent spills because those are more costly for the customer. And then all of these feedback items are now persisted in Query Store. So you can see them, you can query them. And so that feedback persistence is new in SQL 2022. That means if you fail over or if you restart your server, you're not going to lose everything that you've spent all this time learning about your workload. We'll keep it. We also added parameter sensitive plan optimization, which is, I mean, the parameter sensitive plan problem, you've probably heard of it. Are you familiar with the problem?
Oh, yeah. But maybe maybe not everyone is. So why don't you tell us a high level?
Right. The idea is you've got a stored procedure that takes a parameter. You execute that stored procedure with a particular parameter, and you get a plan, a query plan, that is tailored to the value that that parameter embodies at that time of compilation. And let's say that that parameter value had a lot of occurrences in your table. Then you execute again with a different parameter with maybe a lot fewer values. And now you are going to reuse the plan that we created for the very large number of values. So you're going to end up like in a situation where maybe you're building a hash table for a join that you don't really need because it doesn't make sense, right? And so that parameter sensitivity where the plan actually needs to change as the parameter changes, we now have the ability to do that, which is pretty great. We also have optimized plan forcing. So when you force a plan for whatever reason through Query Store, et cetera, in SQL Server, right? Historically, there's a process by which we still have to compile the plan and just kind of choose the forced plan, but optimized plan forcing can kind of short circuit some of those extra compilation steps and cause the compilation to go a lot faster. And then again, approximate percentile is similar idea to a proc count distinct, still invoked with T-SQL, but it's just for percentiles instead of count distinct. Gotcha. And that those features, approx percentile and memory grant feedback, persistence and percentile grant feedback are all GA in SQL DB. They're in SQL 2022 on by default everywhere. Some of these other features are coming soon. They're engine features and they will ship everywhere. So CE feedback, you could expect it. It might be out by the time this video is out. If not, we're expecting it very soon. Similar optimized plan forcing is about that same timeline. It might be out, but it might, or it might be coming soon. And PSP and DOP feedback will be on their tails. So we're hoping to get most of those out to SQL DB within the upcoming months.
Awesome. Well, Kate, it's so great. I've learned so much in this episode. You know, one final question for folks, you know, who might just be getting started or looking at this big list and being like, man, this is a lot of things. Like, should we feel overwhelmed or should we feel excited? Like, how do we look at this big tree of investments from the SQL team?
You should feel super excited because this is the type of thing that you no longer have to do, right? I mean, a lot of these tweaks and these learnings and these adjustments are made on such a per query basis. Like if you had like a team of DBAs working round the clock that were super experts to like tune every single query, like that's a big task, right? And that's overwhelming. But now we're saying, no, you know, you don't need that for most of the common scenarios. The most common scenarios, all that stuff, we kind of automatically do that for you. As long as you're using the latest compatibility level, you'll get all this goodness. And then you can like have your DBA do the more intense stuff, the extra stuff, or maybe things that we haven't gotten to yet.
Yep, I totally agree. I think like the biggest selling point of this is like the it just runs faster. No code changes for a lot of these scenarios. So yeah, I definitely agree. To our viewers, I hope you are excited. If you want to learn more, we'll put some links in the description. You are welcome and encouraged to like this episode and leave us a comment and let us know what you think. We hope you'll check this out in SQL Server and Azure SQL. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.